here by design. God has things on the inside of you that you need to start dreaming about and start thinking about. Nobody's too old, nobody's too young. You are exactly where God has for you. But it's time you dream and think and don't allow the world to just put you in a box. There's greatness inside you. You know, we just had the opportunity to go to Dream Center in LA. It was in April whenever we went. And we got to see three different services, and really it was really cool to be a part of one of the services. Actually, is the guys coming to our camp this year is really excited about it. That was in Beverly Hills, but there was particularly at Dream Center. We came in late, 23 of us, our team, and we came in, and I was just kind of, you know, I'm late to everything, so I just came in and I was like, "What's up?" And they the team had gotten me a seat, and I was kind of right in the front of the balcony, and so I was kind of able to see the entire church just because of where I was, and all of a sudden I really sensed the Spirit of God, and I sensed and really it was amazing. What was happening is during the worship the crowd was pushing the band. I mean, it was about, I don't know, maybe 2,000 people, maybe less, I don't know, but you could sense the Spirit of God just being stirred in the place. It was extraordinary, really. And I was like, all of a sudden I'm looking at, and I'm like crying. I'm like, what am I crying for? I look back at the team and they're all crying. I'm like, what's going on here? Like, what are we going? And it wasn't even like we were like sad because of the little kittens in the shelters or something. It wasn't like an emotional cry. It was the presence of God. And then the preacher gets up and he preached a good message, and then they started worshiping again, and the pastor comes up and he says, "Man, I don't know what's been happening, but the Spirit of God has been moving, and we've just kind of been worshiping about." And they went on to do like five more songs after worship, and everybody stayed and everybody's worshiping. Well, what was happening? I really felt, I was like, "Man, I'm like seeing revival happening." This is what, and what happens is when the church, us, become so enthralled in love with Jesus that we're not satisfied with just normal church. And I'm just gonna tell you, this isn't being recorded, and I'm encouraging you, not trying to discourage you. But we come into different services, pastors, and sometimes there'll be a service, you don't know which one you are. Sometimes there's a service that is kind of like mundane. It's like, and then you'll come in and you'll preach another service and it's like, whoa, like what happened? It was totally, and it's the same band, we're doing the same set, it's the same preacher. What happens is the people. It's where we're located at. And I want to challenge us that every time we come in, that we're sitting at the edge of our seats. Help our pastor out by you coming and be like, "Man, God, I want you to move. I'm hungry for your presence. I'm excited about what you're doing. I'm not just going through life. I'm not just going through the motions of Christianity. I will not be the Pharisee that says, oh, I'm so good. I'm already justified. No, no, no. Father, I need you. I still am in need of you. I'm still in awe of the cross. I'm not done with what you've called me to do." And there's just this stirring. Why? So we don't become religious. The only people that really bothered Jesus was the religious people. The people were so right, so perfect, that they didn't need him. They didn't have time for him. I'm not gonna be that, and neither will you. We will be a generation of people who know our God, walk with him. Man, Sunday mornings become very exciting. When Jesus fills the place, when we begin to talk to our friends, we're like, "Hey, you need to come," and we're like, "I can't explain it. You just need to come." Why? Because God fills the place. Can we just lift? Come on, just one more time. Father, we welcome you here. Don't pass us by. Don't pass us by, Lord. We will not be the religious people that just gather because it's what we do. But Father, we're hungry for more of you today. We're thirsty for your presence. We want to see you move in our lives. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, say hi to your neighbor. Tell them that you're extra good looking today. You're amazing. You got better looking in church. It's a creative miracle for some of you. Come on. Man, we got a good church. I said at first service, I'm going to say it again, Nirvan is amazing on guitar. I'm just going to, because I'm a guitar player, and like what he does is amazing. So give the band a hand. Thank you guys. Sometimes these guys, you know, these guys wake up, these guys wake up at 5:30 a.m. I know I do. And some of them, they probably don't have children, so they just wake up at like 6:15. Or some of them, we have to be here on the platform ready to play at 7:15. That's the goal. So my kids are troopers, but these guys have families, and Autumn has herself, and so it's amazing. But Nirvan has to do his hair. He doesn't just look that good coming out of bed. So they're amazing. I'm being a little funny, but they're really great. Put some great time in for us, and so. Man, I love church. And listen to me, I believe this is just a little admonishment. Don't ignore God for a long time. If he's bothering you about something, go ahead and obey him. You know, it might be hard, and you might be telling you to tell your wife something, it might be telling you to tell your husband something, it might tell you you need to quit something. But if he's bothering you about something, you don't sit on it forever. Go ahead and just obey and keep following him. Even if it, you know, causes some shame or causes some upset, it might be good, because it's better than living a secret life. It's better than living this. Because what happens is God begins to work on people's hearts and challenges them in some areas. And like, they're like, oh, I don't want to do that. You know, they maybe telling, give a car away or something. You're like, oh, get behind me, Satan. You know, and so, and then every time they come to worship, they're like, Jesus, I love you. And he's like, give the car away. You're like, no, I don't want to give the car away. And then you go to baby pray and give the car away. No, I don't want to give the car away. And you argue with God, and then what happens is your relationship really never moves past that. And there's people sometimes who we sit in church for years, the Lord's dealing with us about something, giving something away or working on, you know, he's working on your heart about something, and you're pretending not to hear him. You're pretending to be like, I don't know what the Lord wants from me. Well, he works in mysterious ways, you know. And then that's how you can fall into the trap of just going to church and not really growing and thriving. Sometimes I feel like I've made great strides in my Christianity. I'm not bragging. But it's just because I've just not allowed things to pile up. You know, I've just, whatever God's working on my heart to do, I do. And it's stupid sometimes. It's picking up paper towels in a bathroom, or it's just trying to be obedient. And I make mistakes, and I've made the wrong choices, but I'm like, God, I want to hear your voice, and I just want to do what you've called me to do. Don't move to a city and just sit there knowing that it's not the will of God for your life. Like, that's where you become ill-effective, if you may. That's where you become, you got to do what God's calling you to do. Nothing takes the place. This is free for you. This I'm not charging with anything for this. It's by the Spirit of God. Because you'll miss your relationship. You'll miss what the effects. You're never going to move past that. You have to get to the point of like, okay, I'm just going to obey God. God's God. God's big. God's in charge. He knows what he like literally saw your beginning, and he knows your end. Why would you ignore him and act like you know more than him? Like, no, I got this figured out. No, you don't got your life figured out. He's got you. And go ahead, and you're trusting him with your salvation. Go ahead and trust him with your life. You're like believing that when you die, you're going to float up to heaven and live there, right? That's kind of a crazy belief. How about you just go ahead and trust him with your years here on earth as well? Because I promise you, man, the second you obey, you're like, hey, this is worship is fun. You know, I'm free now. God's not bugging me about anything anymore. And it's a lot better. And you're like, you can actually begin to move on. And listen, nothing takes the place of obedience. You know, people might say like, well, I give more money. God's telling me to give a car away, so I gave more money. No. Give the car away. God told me to, wake up at 7 and pray, but I've been praying at 8. Nothing takes the place of obedience. If he tells you to do something, go do it. And so that was free today. Open up your Bibles to, where are we going? We're going to Mark chapter 9. Continue our series on the confession. What you say about what you say matters. It's so important that we get this right as a church. I believe this church, we are called to put churches up and down the valley. That's our greatness. That's impossible. We couldn't do it on our own. You know what I mean? We're running one campus right now, and I believe we're called to many. We're starting a brand new church, hopefully in the fall in Wilsonville, in a place that has good churches. You know, that's impossible. That seems weird. That seems strange. But this is why. I believe just like a good restaurant, we have a flavor. We have a particular part of the body that we have an obligation to. It's not that we are better than other parts. You know, it's not like the finger is better than the toe. It's just that we have our part to play. And when it comes to faith, healing, and the Holy Ghost, that is our part. A lot of the times churches, other churches won't preach on things like this. It's not, again, like it's not that we are so much better. It's that this is our part that we have to play. This is an understanding that we have been graced in that we have to proclaim and teach and talk about. I believe there's people in cities who have gone to other churches and they're just not fitting. They don't feel right. And so they've left and they're just kind of going through the motions of life. And when they are, finally, when our church comes to town, they're going to say, this is home. And that's why we need to go. So that's my free Wilsonville plug. And that's what we're doing. You know, sometimes people, I don't think we're a mega church yet. And that's not the point. The point is just to do what God's put in pastor's heart. And I believe that's what it is. And so I believe that you have a part to play in that. And that means you might need to fund it. It means you might need a creative business idea that's going to make a lot of money because we need buildings. We need to buy this place. We need to buy both buildings. We need to do some stuff. Or it might mean you might need to go back to school and get some training on business or something. It might you have a part to play in it. Your job is not just to sit there and be like, oh cool, look at them go, watch them go for it, guys. I'm going to the beach, you know, like, that's cool. We want you at the beach, but you should be going to the beach with people bring people with you or something. You have a part to play. And so very excited about our future, very excited about your future, very excited about your kids' future. You know, it's not very long that these little 12-year-olds are going to be 22-year-olds. You know, if you've been sucking wind long enough, you realize that time goes by very quickly. 10 years is nothing. And that's the difference of an 11-year-old and a 21-year-old, you know, and a 21-year-old can do some stuff. And so I took over the youth ministry at 19, and we've got some Matt Coloma. I shouldn't say names because then people, if I forget about somebody, Erica Dippold, Hannah, these are our interns, and they're killing it right now. They preach some messages just recently. I'm like, God is doing some stuff. Why? Because he's getting our foundation larger so that we can hold and do more. And you're a part of it. And so be excited about that. That's all free. Praise the Lord. I'm going to get to the message. Mark chapter 9, verse 14. This is Jesus healing a boy. And the disciples had brought the boy to the father had brought this boy to the disciples, and they could not heal him. And so the father is already at this. I mean, imagine going to up to a service, like, it didn't work. Like, that's where he's at. And this boy has epilepsy. It's a real life thing. And nowadays they just drug him, but back then they didn't have it. And so now they're like, okay, what are we going to do about this? And so this man's in a desperate spot, especially when it's your own kid. You know what I mean? Like, if your kid's ever been sick, you know what this feeling, and I want you to catch this guy's heart, and that's where he's at. He's in a desperate situation, and so they're arguing amongst themselves, and he's like, what's going on? He says, what are you discussing? But verse 17, it says, one of the crowd answered, said, teacher, I brought you my son. He has a mute spirit, and wherever it seizes him, it throws him down, and he foams of the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and he becomes rigid. So I spoke to your disciples that they should cast it out, but they could not. And he answers, says, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? You know, if your pastor said that to you, you'd be offended. You'd be like, how dare he say that? I'm not faithless. But this is what our Savior did to the disciples. He's like, dude, like, really? How long am I going to be with you? I'm going to say that one day. I'll just be hanging out with people. They do something silly. And I'll be like, how long shall I be with you? You know? That's Jesus. He says, "Your faith. How long will I be with you? How long will I bear you?" Like, he's really loving and kind. He says, "Bring him to me." So they brought him, and they saw him, and immediately the spirit convulsed him, and he fell to the ground, and he wallowed, foaming of the mouth. You need to realize that the enemy, when sometimes right before deliverance, he likes to really cause more havoc. And so if you're believing God for something and you're speaking to a situation, you're speaking to a mountain, you're like, yeah, my bills are paid. Then you get an unexpected bill. You're like, praise the Lord. That's not the time to give up. That's not the time to throw in the towel and have a faith failure. That's the time to keep on standing. And the enemy will try and tack you in your mind and say, see, if you just let off, I'll let off. If you don't go to church, nothing, everything's going to be good. And you need to realize that sometimes he's really just stirring up things to see whether you're really going to believe. And so it didn't bother Jesus at all. I mean, I can almost see him standing there. And he says, so how long has this been happening? You know, he begins to make small chat. And he says, how long has this been happening? He says, from childhood, verse 22. And often he throws him into the fire, into the water to destroy him. Sounds demonic to me. But if you, look what he says. He says, but if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Can you hear the desperation in his voice? He's like, please help. And Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible for those who believe. I'm going to read this in New Living Translation. I like it how he says it. He says, the Spirit often tries to throw him. He says, have mercy on us and help us if you can. You know, we sometimes have Christians that are like, if you can, God. But look what Jesus says to him. He says, what do you mean if I can? What do you mean if I can? Anything is possible if a person believes. Keep going. The father instantly cried out and he realizes like, oh no, okay, I need to believe. Yes, I do believe. But help me overcome my unbelief. Have you ever been there in this moment, especially faith teaching? You know, we know it sometimes. We're like, oh, that's wrong. I shouldn't be thinking that. But there's this genuine desperation of this man. He says, Lord, help my unbelief. And I think God saw that. And I think, I mean, you know what? I think you need to understand, honestly, sometimes you can have faith in your heart and doubt in your head. Like, this is freaking me out, Lord, but I trust you. And that's what this man was going through. Today, I'm going to speak to you on the subject of, oh my goodness, I just totally forgot about it. It is called Talk is Expensive. Talk is expensive. It's just a creative. I always try to come up with creative titles. Here we go. Let's pray. Father, help us. Lord, I thank you for the word. Lord, I pray that we would see the words of our mouth are shaping our world. And I pray that we would correct stupid talk from us. And you would help us speak words of faith and be people who are quick to believe you. In Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. You know, this is something we have to get down. Good talk and good confessions are something that we have to really think about and consider. Some people say talk is cheap, and I understand that what they're saying there is like, you can talk about, you know, I'm going to go be this. Well, talk is cheap. You know, who can actually go do it? And that's not really what I'm talking about. Talk is expensive. The thought with that is that your talk and your words can actually cost you time and money. If you have a negative attitude, it can actually begin to affect your life. If you begin to speak over your kids the wrong thing, it's going to cost them. Your talk, what you say over them, becomes very costly. Pastor talks about how his mom would say, you're stinky. You smell like an old man. Those little words began to affect a young man, you know. And it's you know, you're my little booger, or you're such a, you know, you're a little brat. Those words go down very deep and begin to affect, they can cost you. It's expensive. You thinking that you're not good enough, you saying things, oh, I'll never do that, I'll never become that. Man, my little girls, we were driving by the Nike airliner, and there was big jets, right? And they said, Dad, I want to ride in one of those. And right away, my natural knee-jerk reaction would be, oh, baby, we're not going to ride in one of those. Those are for Nike people. But I had to like, no, I'm not going to. They could ride in those if they work for Nike somehow. I don't know. And said, yeah, those are for the people who work at Nike. You could do it if you wanted to, or ride in something similar. Rather than say, we'll never do one of those. One other thing I never say, we can't afford that. Why? I don't want to say, there's a lot of things we can't afford. Let's just be honest. You know, there's a lot of things we can't afford. But I'm not going to talk that way. I'm not going to sit around and just say, man, I can't afford that. Somebody, hey, Dad, can I get one? No, we can't afford that. We're on a budget. Can't afford that. And you can, and people talk that way all the time. Rather, let's say things like, man, we're not going to do that right now with our money. Or say things like, man, how can we afford that? You begin to leave openings for the God to move in your life rather than cutting them off and say, man, we'll never do that. Man, that's that. And listen to me, the heart of today is I believe God is calling you for more. You. I'm not talking to your neighbor right now. I'm talking to you. God is calling you for more, but you have to expand your heart. You have to begin to, God even dealt with me just recently. He said, you need to see Wilsonville campus. I was like, yeah, I do. And he said, no, you need to see Wilsonville campus, your own building. You know, good leaders, they get the thing that they were looking for, and very often they're not excited about it because they already saw it long ago in their heart. And that's the beautiful thing about confession is out of your heart is what you're really believing and speaking. Sometimes people get on the word of faith, people are like, oh, you're just talking. You guys are just talking words. You guys are just trying to stay positive. Well, that's kind of part of it. But the part of our confession is lining up our heart to line up with the word of God. If you can get your heart to line up with the word of God, you can really be in a place of believing. You need to understand that there are some times where you don't even have to confess because you really believe what the word says. And you just simply speak and you declare and that's it. It settles it. But oftentimes our confession, our heart is at such a state that you need to begin to confess so much so that you can change the state of your heart so you can actually change the state of your life. I want to challenge you guys in this. What's your knee-jerk reaction? Oh, we can't afford that. Man, you're such a brat. Whatever those ugly words that you are speaking into your kids, sometimes without even knowing. People say this all the time. Man, I think I'm coming down with something. Why would you say that? Like, at least say like, hey, I'm fighting a cold. Are they like, that's better than, man, I'm coming down with something. No. Don't talk like that. Man, I'm so tired. I'm so weak. Man, it's been a tough week. Listen, if you had a tough week, you had a tough week. I get it. I've had tough weeks. But let's figure out other ways to say things that we want, some things that, man, we want to have. Things, and it's just little things. Why? Because we want the state of our heart to be lined up with what God's got for us. And if we are saying the wrong thing, it can cost you. You know, Brother Hagin said it this way. Most people live, die in their first phase of ministry. Now think about that. When I get to heaven, I want to have like earth stories. You know what I mean by that? I want to have like Moses, me, Peter, we're all kicking it at my house. I got a pool. And we're like, hey, what's up, Mo? And what's up, Peter? You know, just chilling. Peter's a lot like me, so we're going to hang out. And so we're just talking. And Peter's like, I walked on water. Moses like, I broke the Ten Commandments. And what are you going to say? You're going to be like, well, I had a really good Roth IRA. Had a sweet car. Like really? Like what are you going to talk about? And that's where it becomes, are you kingdom minded? Are you dreaming with the help of the Holy Spirit? Are you dreaming like, man, and God will do things in your life and put things on your heart that is impossible by yourself. And it stretches you and it grows you. But why? Because God's like, I want to do more. And that's what I want to challenge you guys. Listen, working a good job and being a good mom and like living a good life, that's good. Like that's not, I don't want us to demean that. But you don't know what kind of kids you could raise if you get your confession right. You don't know, I mean, you being a good mom and a good parent to those kids and speaking words of life over every other night or so when I get to put the kids to bed, I'm praying over my babies. And we say, I ask them like, what do you want to pray about? What are we praying over? What are we believing for? And then I say, Father, I just thank you that my kids are 10 times smarter. Oh, that's awfully pompous. Wow, you can say it about your kids too. You're not limited. Father, I just thank you my kids are sharp. My kids are smart. My kids, they hear the voice of God. The voice of a stranger, they won't follow. They're going to function what they've been called to do. Speaking words of life. Why? Because I want Sydney. I want Kinsey. Man, I'm 10 times smarter. Man, God's with me. Rather than, I'm such a little brat. My teenage years are coming, so I'm going to have to give my mom a hard time because teenage years are tough. You see the difference? Beginning to speak words of life. Man, we can do it. Man, I believe in you. One of my goals this year is just to be more encouraging. I want us to begin to say words like, man, I believe in you. Man, you can do it. I'm on your side. Why? Because people need to hear it. You can shape and frame your world by the words you speak, the words that are coming out of your mouth. And I'm not talking about here, you know, we're pretty good because we're a faith church. We've heard this before. So sometimes around each other, we're very good. Like, hallelujah, brother. Amen. The Lord is good all the time, all the Christianese that we do, it's cool. But what do you do at home? Man, I always get stuck in this stupid traffic. Really? I don't want to ride with you. I want to challenge you in your thinking and your talking and your behaving. Sometimes it's good just to keep your mouth shut. If you're like, I'm gonna say some things right now, but I'm not going to. Because I'm gonna change what's in my heart. I'm gonna speak only words of life. Ephesians tells us, only speak those things that edify the hearer. Man, and that's tough. Dude, it's tough. But I wanna challenge us in this. Keep going. Luke chapter 6. talk is expensive. Luke chapter 6, verse 43, it says, a good tree can't produce bad fruit. Isn't that good news? Because you're good trees. You cannot produce bad fruit. Good trees cannot produce bad fruit. And a bad tree can't produce good fruit. Sometimes people tell me, like, I hang out with my friends and they smoke weed, and they're good people. No, no, no. They can't produce good fruit. They love the Lord, just they don't know it yet. Well, okay, whatever. You just disagree with the Bible. That's fine. A tree is identified by its fruit. Figs are never gathered from thorn bushes, and grapes are not picked from bramble bushes. A good person produces good things from the treasury of a good heart. An evil person produces evil things from the treasury of an evil heart. What you say flows from what is in your heart. That's why confession is so important. We've had a couple of times where we've had instances in our life by I know the very first thing that came out my mouth determined what we got. And Sydney, she had pooped in the water. This was just one of those moments where I just hooked up my faith with my confession. And thanks be to God, I saw it. You know, I'm not trying to brag. Jesus is the author, developer of our faith. Remember that. And so sometimes, some of you big faith people, just remember, you still need Jesus. And so I was sitting there in the operating room, and or not the operating room, whatever they call it, the birthing place. And it's like a hotel, very expensive. And my wife's in the, and they said the baby just pooped in the water. And we had just heard about a mom who passed away, and the baby passed away when the baby did this because it got distressed and bacteria, and just it was bad. And so instantly I saw in Pastor Rebecca's eyes, like, uh-oh. And I just right away, as the dad, as the one who's authority over my household, I said, no, she'll be just fine. That's all I said. It wasn't a big, great prayer, but it was one of belief. What was in my heart, I spoke what I wanted. And it's very important that you know, you get an unexpected bill. How are we going to pay this? Don't say things like that. But what needs to happen is you need to renew your mind to the Word of God. Because your knee-jerk reaction sometimes like, well, great, now we're going to be broke. Don't say things like that. Say things, man, God's going to have to come through on this one. Man, God's going to get creative in this. Man, God's going to get the glory out of this one. And people will look at you strange, but it's okay. They can have the rest of the turmoil that comes their way. You can just be the different one. And guys, this is not normal. People will look at you strange. And sometimes I don't want you making like big confessions around your family. Like they're gonna look at you like you're strange. But do it privately. Man, God's coming through. Man, God's gonna do good things in my life. And you won't. It'll be moving past just a positive person into a faith person. One time, a person came up to me and says, Pastor, now I'm tired of faking it. I'm just tired of faking it. Everybody's so happy. I'm tired of it. I'm like, whoa. If you think you're faking it, if you've not really put the word in your heart to the point where it's real. It's not just about, how you doing? Blessed and overcoming, brother. You know, it's not just saying the right words. It's believing the right things. It starts here. It's down. It's in your heart. And you can't fake that. It's either there or not. I want to challenge you. What's in your heart? What comes out when stressful situations arise? What comes out of your heart? Man, are you speaking words of life? And listen, God wants to do some cool things in your life, but he's got to get you to think bigger. Man, I can do it. Man, God could do that. Man, I could start that business. Man, it could be, God could bless that. Man, I believe I could do that. Just expanding yourself. Look at Proverbs 18. You guys doing okay this morning? Proverbs 18, verse 20, you can literally eat by the fruit of your mouth. Look at this. A man's stomach shall be satisfied from the fruit of his mouth. That's what the Bible says. Proverbs 18, verse 20 says, a man's stomach shall be satisfied from the fruit of his mouth and from the produce of his lips. That means what are you producing out your mouth? You will be filled. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And those who love it will eat of its fruit. Start saying things, man, I'm gonna make it. Man, God's got good things for me. Man, my best days are ahead. You know, you ever met that guy who's like just his best days were in high school? You know, he's still got the Letterman jacket and a tie-dye t-shirt, tells you how he used to all-star something. Like, oh, cool, that's great. What did you do yesterday? My best days are ahead of me. I've not peaked yet. I don't care if I'm 86, I'm gonna say my best days are ahead of me. Why? Because God's not done with me. I'm still sucking wind. God, I'm going to still do something more for the kingdom of God. I'm going to do something heavenly. Like I said, I want heaven stories when I'm or earth stories when I'm in heaven. Like, hey, we built churches in the least church state in the whole union. I had a buddy who started a church over in Florida, and he was working with a company who was helping. They're very smart on like how to plant churches. It's called Ark, I think, something like that. Anyways, they dropped him. They said, you know what? You're like, there's no chance of you really starting a church statistically. We love you. Have a good time. But we can't support that because you're in the second least churched area in the union. And he says, I said, well, what's the first? He says, Portland. But God's going to do a great work here. Come on. If we can believe it, all things are possible. And it's easy to like, all things are possible to those who believe. You know, when you get fired from your job, all things are possible for those who believe. My job's not my source. You ever met somebody, that's all they talk about is what they do? Like, oh, who are you? Like, oh, I'm a physician and this and that. Oh, cool. What do you do? Oh, I'm a, no. What do you do? Who are you? What your occupation isn't who should shape you. It's what God's got for you. It's where God's taking you. It's what you're doing potentially with that occupation. Man, I'm gonna build a school. Man, I'm gonna build an orphanage. Man, I'm gonna go overseas. I'm gonna help people. What's in your heart? Because God's got more for you. That's what we're talking about today. Talk can be expensive. Talk can cost you. Look at Numbers chapter 13. And I couldn't get away from this story. I've preached this before. You may remember it. You may not. I don't know. I've talked about this story. This is the story when the Moses sent out 12 spies to the land of Canaan. Now listen, this was an extraordinary trip. They took almost 1 million people, maybe eight, some people say that it was 8 million people. They took a whole bunch of people and they made this exodus, and it was a two-week journey. It shouldn't have taken them 40 years. It wasn't that long. But what happened is they began to complain and they didn't believe God. They didn't trust God. God says, you're going to do this. And they said, we can't. What are you saying in your life that God says, you can do this? And you say, no, I can't. I could never do that. And it could cost you. It could literally cost you. It could cost your children. It could affect what is happening in your life by just what you believe, by what you think is possible. So this is what's happening. Just to kind of catch us up on this story, he sent these guys out, and they come back. They got some grapes. It was amazing. They spied out the land. They found out that it was amazing. They pomegranates and figs and everything like that. And they went up to these different parts and verse, and they came back and they begin to tell them. Verse 27. Then they told him. He said, "We went to the land where you sent us, and it truly flows with milk and honey." They're like, "Yes, this place is amazing." They got like hammocks and stuff. This is some of its fruit. And they're like, here's some grapes. And like throwing them out at people. It's like one of those crowd giveaways. Like, yeah. Okay, just waking you up. The cities were fortified and very large. They had like a t-shirt gun. I'm just joking. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell in by the sea and along the banks of the Jordan. And Caleb quieted the people before Moses, and he said, "Let us go up at once and take possession, for we are well able to overcome it." Man, this Caleb guy, they start telling, well, there's a bunch of giants in the land, here's some fruit, but I don't know, these people dwell here. And he's like, he saw where their first reaction was going to go. And he says he quieted the people. He's like, whoa, 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 whoa. I see where this is going. I see. He says, let's go up at once and take it. You need those kind of people in your life. Come on, let's do it. God's well able. But look what happened. Their negative attitude. He quieted the people. But, watch out for the big but. But the men who had gone up with him, he says, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. And they gave the children of Israel a bad report of the land which they had spied out. One version says an evil report. We think evil like witches or Halloween. Ah, evil. No. Unbelief is evil. Unbelief is like temporary atheism. Yeah, that's what I said. Atheism. It's basically thinking like, nah, God's not going to come through on this one. Like, really? God's not? I mean, think about Israel. They just like walked across on dry land. They're being fed by from heaven, right? There's a pillar of fire like leading them. They're already living some pretty extraordinary stuff. Why wouldn't they just be like, huh, brought me this far, let's go. But instead they're like, well, this is where God's impossible. And we do it all the time. We're like, we believe in heaven. Yes, I'm going to heaven. How about you trust him with your now and your rent? I believe that when I die, my heart stops beating. I'm going to float mysteriously up to this place. It's going to be amazing. I don't know if God can get me some rent, though. Like really? Like, that's where he's like, oh, man, I'm going to heal the sick. I'm going to raise the dead. Rent. Oh, I don't know about that one. Like, come on, really? We serve a big God. Nothing's impossible for those who believe. Nothing's impossible for those who believe. So Caleb quieted the people, and they didn't listen to him. And he says, look at this, verse 33. They saw the giants, the descendants of Anak came from the giants, and we were like grasshoppers in our own sight. He says, we thought this way about ourselves, and so were we in their sight. You know, the way you think about yourself matters. The way your knee-jerk reaction, the things that are coming up out of your heart when tough situations arise, what you think you can and cannot do will affect your life. And if you are saying the wrong thing, it can cost you. So ended up these people, verse 14, Numbers 14, God decided, okay, let's kill them all. And so God wanted to kill them. And Moses was like, no, God, I don't think that's a good idea. Let's talk about this. And he petitioned, God, please don't kill everybody. And God obeyed. And that's nice to have that kind of relationship with the Lord. And so he's like, no, don't kill them. And he says, but verse 20, Numbers 14, 20, he says, the Lord said, okay, I'll listen. And he says, I pardon according to your word. But truly as I live, and all the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord. Because all these men who have seen my glory and the signs which I did in Egypt and in the wilderness and have put me to the test now these 10 times and have not heeded my voice, they certainly shall not see the land which I swore to my fathers, nor shall any of those who have rejected me see it. Remember, talk is expensive. It can cost you. These people, 40 years is a long time. Now, if I was like an 18-year-old, I'd just be mad. I was like, man, I was gonna go get a house, I was gonna get a wife, and now I'm gonna be like, oh, by the time I get there, thanks, guys. Thanks for your Debbie Downer attitude. Now, listen, sometimes people are like, well, I'm a realist. I'm just a realist. I just like to say it like it is. Listen, the reality is that you're blessed. The reality is that God loves you and has a plan. That's the reality. You are not stooped in reality when you're all negative. And if you're a Christian, you've been bought with a price. God says you're blessed coming in and blessed coming out. That's the reality, and you're not convinced of it. You're actually walking in a fantasy when you think that God doesn't like you. You're not a realist at all. I want to challenge you. Even the budget keepers in here, God's got more for you. God's got bigger things. God's got ways. God's got people in that could write you a check and take care of all your problems. Don't limit him to your job and to what you know and what you see. You begin to expand your thinking. Look at this. It says, God's like, nobody ain't coming in. Everybody 20 and younger. Verse 24, but my servant Caleb, because he has a different spirit. You know what your family's gonna make fun of you? Why are you such a weirdo? I have a different spirit. And he followed me fully. I will bring into the land where he went, and his descendants shall inherit it. And actually, you know, it's kind of a funny story. You read on Joshua, they after 40 years, they finally go inhabit. And it says that Caleb, 88 years old, he comes in. He says, hey, I want my mountain. You know, at 88 something years old, I'd be a little bitter, you know. I'd be like, I was 40 when we came into this thing, and now we're old. But he, you know what he says? He says, I am just as able as I was then as I am now. You know, when you're holding on to the things of God, it will sustain your life. Some of you are, well, I'm too old. You're not Jacob, you're not Caleb's age yet. Get to that attitude, man. I'm well able. God's not done with me yet. And listen, I really feel like it's the Lord. Pick these things up. Some of you guys, we've dropped dreams. We've put them down. We're like, yeah, I don't think I ever do those, man. I don't know what I was thinking. Maybe I didn't hear from the Lord. And therefore, you just kind of come bump through life. And listen, We are not called, I'm going to close right here. We're not called to walk in children of darkness, but we're called to walk as children of light. Meaning, I was really, God actually corrected me. I was, you know, with Wilsonville, and sometimes I'm like, man, I'm going to go take over the city. I don't know. We're just going to go and trust the Lord. And he was saying, there's exact ways I'm going to do it, but you need to come in fellowship with me so you know what I'm saying. And your life, there's very specific things that you need to be doing. There's very specific things that you're called to do. There's very specific steps you could take. Maybe it's going back to school. Maybe it's putting your hand to something. Maybe it's an idea. I don't know. But there's very specific things. But you will only get those answers in the prayer closet. You won't get them. You won't get them. They're not just going to fall on you just because God wants you to have them. There's a closeness that needs to happen with the Lord. And so right now, you can start. Tomorrow, you can start. It just takes putting down the TV long enough, maybe shutting down the Netflix subscription for just a couple of weeks and say, man, God, I'm going to seek your face. I'm going to find out what you've got for my life so that we can begin to make progress. Why? Because I do not want to live and die in the wilderness. I'm not going to do that. I'm not just going to waste my time. That's not why I'm here. That's not my point. I'm not going to be sitting up there in heaven and Moses talking, Pastor Nate's talking, and I have nothing to talk about. I'm going to have kingdom business. Man, I did this. God put this on my heart, and it was a successful business, and we were able to fund much of what the church needed to do, and man, God was faithful. Man, come on, dream, church. Please dream. Why? Because our church depends on it. We can't do this ourselves. We need you. We need every one of us functioning at full capacity, doing what God's called us to do. And I promise you, as we begin to do this, God just unfolds things and dreams. And he will begin to trust you with things that you never thought possible. You're like, man, the Lord put this in my lap. I didn't think I could do this. Man, it's crazy. I can't believe I got this opportunity. You'll be able to stand on platforms that you never thought were possible just because you obeyed the Lord. I want to challenge you in this. Pick it up. Pick the dream up. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the word today. Lord, I thank you for every person here, young, old, everybody in the sound of my voice. And Father, I pray that you would speak to us exactly where the next step that we're supposed to be making in obedience to your word and the things we need to begin to say and speak over our lives, just like Caleb saying, yeah, we're well able. We can do it. But Father, that faith has to come from the heart. Father, I pray that we would be steeped in the foundation of Jesus. We love you. Every head bowed, every eye closed, no one messing around. I just want to take a second. The very beginning of this is to know Jesus and to walk with him. The very beginning of serving him and saying the right things. It's not just mind over matter. It's Jesus over matter. It's Jesus over the point. So if you've never asked Jesus into your heart, you've never said, Jesus, come into my life, made that very first confession, I want to give you that opportunity today. Just as a moment of reflection, I want you to shoot your hand up high and bold, and then I'm just going to pray over you. This is your moment. Or maybe you said that prayer at one point, but you fell back. What I mean by that is you fell away from it. Jesus has not been your Lord. You've been kind of, you took the wheel back, if you may. You've been driving your life. And you realize today, like, man, I want to get back on track. I want to start following him like I should. I want to be who he's called me to be, and I'm not wasting time in the wilderness. If that's you, I want you to raise your hand high and bold on the count of three. One. All right, I see that hand. We're already working on people. Praise God. God's working on you, man. Two. Come on, if this is your day, this is your day. Let's not waste time. Three. Come on, I see those hands. All right, praise God. Praise God. They're all over the building. Praise the Lord. All right, I'm not going to embarrass you by any means, but I would like everybody to stand up with me. Praise God for you raising your hand. We're going to pray a prayer. And those who raise your hand, it's so simple. Sometimes we fall away from the Lord. Listen, this thing's a journey. This thing, we talked even on Wednesday night, serving the Lord is a marathon, not a sprint. You know, it's fun to, sprint. It's fun to beat people, but it sucks when you got to do it forever. And so what I mean by that is this is a long process. You're going to have ups, you're going to have downs. But the truth of it is that you keep your heart on the Lord. You keep your heart remembering that you are forgiven, loved, and there is nothing that can remove you from his hand. And that's a serious knowledge that we've got to get. And sometimes even as the body of Christ, we beat ourselves up when we slip. We beat ourselves up. We're like, man, I'm stupid now. Now I'm not going to fulfill the call. Listen, just God's used a bunch of screwed up people in the Bible. I'm sure he's going to continue to use you. You're in good company. And so the biggest thing is you're only really out when you quit, when you stop dreaming, when you start saying, man, and that's what I was talking about a little bit. Don't let sins pile up. Don't let an attitude that you just kept having, get forgiveness and move on. So let's say this real bold. Say, Father God, I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. Not my plan any longer, but his plan. I surrender my life. I surrender my ways, my thoughts, everything I do. He's my Lord. He's my Savior. I believe he died for me. And he rose again. I confess it. I believe it. And I'm going to live for him all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Can we give them a hand? Come on. That's a big deal.